Hi, I'm Jeff Klein, editor of Radiographics, and today I'm pleased to have with us Dr. Minnie Pathria from the University of California, San Diego Medical Center, Department of Radiology, who is the senior author of a featured paper in the current January 2018 issue of Radiographics entitled Magnetic Resonance Imaging of Muscle Trauma, Anatomy, Biomechanics, Pathophysiology, and Imaging Appearance. Welcome, Dr. Pathria.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning. Minnie, your paper in the current issue begins with an introduction that reviews the spectrum of acute, subacute, and chronic muscle injuries, and these are listed in Table 1. Can you review the table with us and give us an indication as to which of these injuries a radiologist is most likely to encounter in clinical practice?
Sure. You know, the reason I decided to break this down is I think that we emphasize acute trauma, and obviously I think that's what most of us deal with in our practices when a patient is injured. But I think radiologists also really need to be familiar that there are functional abnormalities and symptoms related to old injuries that may not be as obvious on MR, or more subtle abnormalities like delayed onset muscle soreness that may not be as flagrant, and you might not have that history of acute injury, and that we're responsible for those as well. So obviously having a history of a timeline of symptoms is useful, but that's the way I try to break it down in my head. It's the acutely injured patient, somebody in the first 2 to 6 weeks after a trauma, or somebody that had a remote trauma and is still having some sequelae from it.
Sure. Well, thank you. So, you know, after you go through the classification, the spectrum of injuries based on timeline, the next part of the paper reviews normal muscle structure and function, which is obviously important. And then you delve into the main forms of muscle injury, which begin with indirect injuries, which include muscle strain and delayed onset muscle soreness. Let's discuss the most common form of strain or tear, which occurs at the myotendinous junction. And we'll review figure 6 as an example of this.
So, you know, strain is something that all of us that deal with sports, either in professional athletes or in weekend warriors, see quite frequently. And I think the spectrum of what you're going to encounter varies on your practice, because most of these are actually injuries we see in younger adults. And if your practice is very heavy with geriatrics, they're more tendon pathology than muscle pathology that we're going to see. But in terms of you know, what we encounter most commonly in our practice, it's often under-conditioned athletes rather than professional athletes that experience these types of traumas because they're not doing the exercise correctly, their form may not be correct, or they overdo it, and they wind up either getting delayed onset muscle soreness because of too much exercise that they're not ready to do, or wind up getting a frank strain because they slip, fall, twist, or something during the activity itself. So in terms of figure 6, it's actually a little bit more of an unusual type of injury to see a complete tear like this at the myotendinous junction. At least in our practice, the injuries tend to be lower grade. Usually the clinicians are very astute at picking up a complete tear, as we have in this example, where the rectus femoris muscle belly was completely separated from the quadriceps tendon and with a large fluid gap distally. This was actually a radiologist, not the most conditioned, participating in soccer.
Thank you for that. In discussing muscle strains, you focus on the variation in muscle architecture and how this impacts the location and configuration of the myotendinous junction and its effects on the associated MR and ultrasound findings in patients who are affected by this. Can we review this concept by looking at figure 7, which I think nicely illustrates the differences between parallel and pinnate muscles? And then we can look at figure 10, which illustrates a commonly strained pinnate muscle.
I think this is actually the most important concept in this paper and something that I personally wasn't aware of. And I've been interested in muscle injury for a long time until several years ago, how important the architecture is in terms of what the imaging findings are going to look like after a muscle injury. I had a Popeye muscle picture in my head from medical school that the tendon was always in the middle with muscle fibers converging to it, and never understood why so many muscle injuries showed so much fluid on the surface of the muscle. And in fact, the powerful muscles in our body, in our hamstrings in particular, that are commonly injured, all have this pennate architecture where there's no true tendon inside the muscle belly, but it rides on the surface as an area of collagen thickening. And so all the injuries tend to be on the surface of the muscle. It's just not the way that I think we think about muscle normally. In fact, the bipennate architecture where the tendon rides centrally in the muscle is more commonly seen in the upper extremity, in the hands, in the supraspinatus, for example. Those types of strains look very different. They don't have much edema. I think we tend to undergrade injuries in that kind of muscle and overgrade injuries in the muscles that have a superficial tendon. So I think this is really something that really changed how I read, because you need to titrate the amount of fluid is going to be very different with the two types. And I'm sorry, you wanted to refer to a figure.
Yeah, figure 10, I think, shows, a nice example of a common.
Yes. So this is an injury here in the biceps femoris, which is the most commonly strained, very powerful, with a very strong superficial tendon, just illustrating that the pathology doesn't necessarily look muscular. You might interpret this as fascial disease or even subcutaneous edema because it's all riding on the surface. And another concept that's important with these architecture when you have superficial tendons is that a lot of muscles have a tendon on one side proximally and on a different side distally. And if you go back to the diagram, you can see this relationship, and that's true for all of the hamstrings, is that the tendon starts, for example, medially, proximally, and then winds up being lateral distally. So the actual side that's injured can reverse relationships as you move from proximal to distal. And I think just looking at a lot of normal cases, you can appreciate that. It's just one of those subtleties that, you know, when you're busy reading a stack, you may not really focus on.
Sure. Thanks. So let's move on to the issue of delayed onset muscle soreness, which is another indirect injury that you described. Can you describe for us what this injury actually entails? And we'll look at figure 17, which is an example, I think, of this type of injury.
Well, delayed onset muscle soreness has been known about for a long time clinically in patients who perform some activity, usually one that they're not doing regularly, a new activity or an increased level of activity, and they don't have symptoms at the time, but develop soreness 2 to 3 days later. So we all know about this. You know, I know to start taking Motrin the day I go skiing because it's going to hurt like hell by 2 days in. But until MR, the only way to really assess this was by biopsy, which nobody really wants to have to do. And they know there are changes in free water concentration, and it's been shown that there's microscopic sarcomere damage. And that was shown in the 70s. But really, MR has allowed us to see this effectively, I think, for the first time. I think ultrasound is not very sensitive to this. And it's a bizarre look on MR because it's often just one muscle. And if you don't get the accurate history that they did something unusual, like weightlift for 3 hours or go swim training, or in this particular case, this was a child given a twist board at Christmas who twisted the next day for hours, you may not really know what you're looking at. I think the thing it's hardest to distinguish from sometimes is a denervated muscle, which can also have this uniform pattern of edema, but the swelling is not a feature that you'd see with denervation. That's the best clue that you're dealing with DOMS. But you've got to ask the patient, did you do something? I mean, it could have been weeks ago. They may not recall. Because this has been lost for a long time.
Right. Terrific. Well, so, Dr. Pathria, the contusions are a common direct traumatic injury. And you mentioned in the paper, these are the second most common reason for professional athletes to miss playing time, second only to strains. Figure 19 is an example of the most common of these injuries. Can you describe these contusions? And we'll look at figure 19 as an example.
Yeah. So contusion injuries are quite different than a strain because the history is usually quite obvious. There's a direct blow, and there may be, you know, good clues to us, like a bone bruise underneath it or skin hematoma overlying the area. So we tend to see these, for example, in our soccer and professional football players. who wind up having a direct impact. It's not that common an injury that we see in our general practice. We tend to be more in a knife and gun club hospital, so we see a lot of penetrating trauma. But the history is usually quite evident. And what I think is interesting about these is they look much worse than strain, and they do much better than strain. They heal more quickly. So I think the important take home is that the myotendinous junction and tendon are a bigger problem in terms of healing than muscle tissue itself. But really, they don't have anything to do with the tendon localization that strain does. They have a different appearance. I used to write in the old days that they look the same, and they really don't look the same.
Great. So speaking about penetrating injuries, muscle lacerations are the result of penetrating injury, obviously. And in your paper, figure 26 illustrates a patient with a laceration within a neck muscle. Can we just look at that case?
You know, I actually don't have a large number of cases of penetrating trauma on MR because we rarely image them. If it's a presumed deep injury, if there's any type of neurovascular question at all, the patient will go straight to surgery. So I don't think there's much indication for doing imaging. And as I went through my cases, many of the lacerations that I had were older cases where there was a concern for infection or an infected hematoma, which weren't really suitable for this paper. So really, imaging an acute laceration, in my opinion, is rarely indicated. The only main questions are vascular, and we handle those really with CTA at our institution. So I have a lot of lacerations from stingrays, barbs winding up in feet, but I didn't think that quite qualified. But that's the most common laceration on muscle that I see in my practice.
Sure. So next in your paper is a review of connective tissue disorders, and that's followed by a section on muscle healing. Can we talk about the stages of muscle healing from the injuries that you've detailed in the paper, and in particular, how MR factors into the decision of when athletes can return to play after muscle injury?
You know, muscle healing is a really complicated topic, and I'm going to give you a simplistic way of looking at it, which is that it either heals and becomes muscle again, which is good, and in many cases, it doesn't become muscle again, and it becomes something else. It becomes fat, or it becomes collagen with scar, or in a worst-case scenario, we have a myositis, a specific cancer, some other abnormal tissue that forms. That normal healing phase, it's not linear. There are many stages, and they overlap in time. So you may have a lesion that's undergoing resorption in one portion and regeneration in another portion. So there's a considerable heterogeneity, especially in large muscle injuries and how healing takes place. I don't think that there is convincing literature at this time that MR predicts the quality of the healing that takes place. A lot of things that look normal on delayed MR don't function normally. It doesn't stretch as well. And compliance is a big issue in muscle. It needs to change length. That's how it works. And we only look at it statically, and we're not good at recognizing loss of compliance and tissue stiffness. So I think maybe with elastography or newer techniques, we'll do better. We're only really looking at the amount of fluid that's there, and the healing process happens faster clinically than it looks like it's happening on MR. There's definitely a lag on MR.
Great. So in the final section of your paper, you discuss the grading systems for muscle injury. Can we just discuss the relevance of these systems to the imaging of muscle injuries? And we'll take a look at figure 2 as you discuss this, which I think lists some of the more commonly used muscle injury grading systems. I mean, how important is this to the practicing musculoskeletal radiologist to be aware of these systems?
You know, I think it's really important because I hate to make people's lives complicated, because usually a good paper should simplify people's lives. But the old 3-grade grading system that we've been using is deeply flawed. It doesn't separate strain from contusion, something very fundamental to how long it's going to take an athlete to come back. And it correlates very poorly with return to activity. So while it's simple to use, we don't really have good criteria other than a grade 3, which is a complete tear, for looking at those and predicting anything very accurately. So I think you need to move on from that. My personal favorite out of all of these is the British athletic system. That seems to be the one that's becoming most widely used. And it really pays emphasis to the size of the lesion in terms of its length and cross-section. But more importantly, it really focuses on whether there is tendon injury and where that's located precisely. Is it inside the muscle or on the surface of the muscle? And so I would suggest that if you're going to learn one system, to use British athletics. It's actually quite easy to use. It divides strain from contusion. You have to give some dimensions of the lesion in terms of cross-sectional involvement and length. Describe precisely where the area is abnormal and pay a little bit of detailed attention to whether there is tearing or swelling or some sort of derangement of the tendon itself. So I think the three isn't going to work. Our clinicians don't have any respect for the moderate grade report. It doesn't really help them very much.
Terrific. Well, Dr. Pathria, I want to thank you for taking the time today to discuss your paper in the current January 2018 issue of Radiographics, which deals with the MR imaging of muscle trauma. It's a really important topic. There's not much out there in the literature on this, and really appreciate your contribution to the journal and sharing your expertise with the audience today.
Thank you so much for having me. Thank you.
Thanks.